Good afternoon, everybody. Let's begin by talking about clinical practice. Why are we physicians and why do we become doctors? We primarily serve three purposes. We help to diagnose disease in patients, we help to treat patients, we prescribe medication, and we also prevent diseases. When we give vaccines, what we are doing is actually preventative treatment. So in a sense, clinical practice deals with an individual patient, okay? It deals with the well-being of an individual patient, and there is a reasonable expectation of success when you're dealing with an individual patient. But unlike that, research is a different ballgame. So if you were to look at clinical practice, you would define it as interventions which are solely intended to enhance the well-being of an individual patient with the reasonable expectation of success. On the other hand, you have research. What do you do in research? In research, you have a hypothesis. You see, maybe drug A will be better than drug B. So once you have a hypothesis, you formulate a protocol. Once you have a protocol, you have objectives of the protocol. You have efficacy outcomes, safety outcomes. You do the study after ethics committee approval, consent, and you reach some conclusions. And what you do at the end of it is actually to generalize your results. You say that I found in my study that A is better than B, and therefore everybody in clinical practice should switch from B to A. So what you're really doing in research is testing a hypothesis which leads to generalizable knowledge. So research deals with populations, whereas practice deals with individual patients. So when you're dealing with research and we are looking at a large number of patients, why is it that we should be concerned about ethics in clinical trials? And we should be concerned for three or four basic reasons. Clinical trials are primarily experimental. Okay, you don't know what is going to happen. In practice, you know that you have a certain expectation of success. Research can be unsuccessful. You're dealing with products which are investigational, so you have limited information on safety and efficacy at the point of doing research. You're using human beings as participants who volunteer to take part in your study, right? And finally, there are additional complexities in the Indian context, which I shall come to in a minute. These are the three or four reasons why ethics becomes very, very important when one does clinical trials or clinical research. About 6 or 7 years back, there was this paper which was published by Emmanuel Ezekiel in the Journal of American Medical Association. And you had the Tuskegee studies, and you have the Henry Beecher's articles in the New England Journal of Medicine, you had the Nazi experiments, so you have the Belmont Report, the Nuremberg Code, and you have the US FDA guidelines, India GCP guidelines, ICA GCP guidelines. He kind of nicely summarized it in a single paper, and he said that there are about 7 universal requirements for ethics, which is more or less what I discussed in the morning, the 13 principles he's condensed into these 7 principles. Then any research that you do should have value for society, so there is a scientific and societal value. It should be valid, okay, so you have a good hypothesis, a good protocol. There should be fair subject selection, so you don't exploit people who have diminished autonomy or who are vulnerable. There should be a favorable risk-benefit ratio. It should undergo independent review by an ethics committee or an independent review board. There should be informed consent, which is given freely, and you respect all the subjects that participate in your studies. Question is, do all these principles actually, are they actually followed in clinical practice? Do we actually do really ethical clinical trials? I'll illustrate this with a few examples from this country and outside the country. Let's take 2 of these universal requirements, scientific validity and a favorable risk-benefit ratio. Let's start with this. In 1997, 1 year after the ICA-GCP guidelines were released, we were asked by a pharmaceutical company to do a study which looked at 2 antimalarials. At that point, what happened in India was that there was a lot of problem of multi-drug resistant falciparum malaria, and the Chinese medicine artemisinin had just come into the market, and China was very successful and was using artemisinin very, very successfully. So it was decided by the World Health Organization that one needs to test artemisinin derivatives in countries where there is a problem of multidrug resistant falciparum malaria. So we had 2 groups. It was a randomized controlled trial. One group received chloroquine and the second group received the new molecule, which was coartemether. Coartemether is actually artemisinin artemether plus a second molecule, which is lumefantrine or benflumeter. So this was a randomized 1:1 study. That means every patient who got chloroquine would also receive coartemether for every one patient. We had ethics committee permission for this study. We also had permission from the Drugs Controller General of India for the study, and we decided to do the study. Our sample size for the study was 252. That means about 125 would receive one drug, another 125 would receive the other drug. When we had finished about 160 patients, somewhere, you know, close to the 2/3 of the study, we had this patient, WMR. He's a 40-year-old man with uncomplicated Plasmodium falciparum malaria. He had an asexual parasite count of 35,000, 36,000, and our inclusion criteria was 1,000 parasites to 1 lakh parasites. So he satisfied the inclusion criteria. We talked to him, he gave written informed consent, and we started him on the study. Now, since it was a double-blind study, we were not aware of which medication he had got. Not only was it double blind, it was also a double dummy study. So we absolutely had no clue what he was receiving. Patient started getting better. His parasite count got less. His fever became better. He started looking brighter, better. On the fifth day when we actually saw him, patient was still febrile. This parasite count had drastically come down. So it was 808 parasites per microliter. And at that point, the principal investigator, and at that time I was the sub-investigator, co-investigator, and we started thinking that should we be initiating rescue medication? I mean, isn't it too long, 5 days? Should we be giving him something, or should we just wait on and see whether he comes out of it? On day six, we got a call at 12 in the afternoon saying that this patient had developed acute respiratory distress syndrome. And by 1 o'clock, the patient was dead, died of malaria. We opened the code, you know, so you have this sealed envelope with the patient's randomization number, and we opened the code and we realized that the patient had received chloroquine, right? The trial was stopped. The sponsor did an interim analysis at that point of time. And what the sponsor found was very surprising. When we started the study, or rather when we decided to start the study, the problem of chloroquine resistance was about 5%, okay? Just 5% chloroquine resistance, and therefore we had a competitor. When we analyzed the data after interim analysis, the chloroquine resistance was 50%. Why did the chloroquine resistance rise from 5% to 50%? The answer lies in the last line. Resistance patterns alter dramatically in the time taken for regulatory approval. The company approached us in 1996 to do the study. We submitted the data to the drugs controller, who gave the permission for the study in 1998. Nobody had looked at resistance patterns in 2 years. So the question is, did we do a scientifically valid study? Should chloroquine have at all been the competitor when we started off doing the study, or should the competitor have been something else? I'm not quite sure. The other thing which we realized when we looked at the protocol later, you know, after the death of this patient, it was a turning point for all of us, that when you do studies in HIV, when you do studies in falciparum malaria, or when you do studies in cancer, the risk incurred by patients is actually fairly high. And also, there are studies which have shown that investigators often follow study protocols very, very dutifully, sometimes regardless of the subject's best interest, which is perhaps what we may have done at that point. And in this particular protocol, the timing of rescue medication, when should we start something else when we realize that the patient is not responding to your drug in question, was not specified, perhaps because the efficacy of that particular product at that point in time was not known and the drug had been actually given a chance by the protocol. So did we do a study which was scientifically valid, and did we do a study which had a favorable risk-benefit ratio? We published a study in 2000 so that at least other people could learn a lesson from our own mistake. I'll take two other examples, two other universal requirements: fair subject selection and respect for all subjects. This was a paper published in the New England Journal of Medicine in 2004. Single dose perinatal nevirapine, P plus standard zidovudine to prevent mother-to-child transmission of HIV-1 infection in Thailand. The study was designed to test the superiority of nevirapine regimen over placebo at 80% power and 5% significance using one-sided tests assuming a transmission rate of placebo 8% and 4% in the nevirapine group. So herein you had a randomized clinical trial done in Thailand, 1:1. One group receives placebo and the other group receives nevirapine. Okay. Now this paper, which was published in 2004, was among a lot of other publications which snowballed into what became known as the 1997 standard of care controversy. Okay. People realized that subjects who were in developing countries were actually being treated differently than subjects in developed countries. So there were a lot of publications which came out at this point, ethics and international research, ethical complexities of conducting research in developing countries, ethics of placebo-controlled trials of zidovudine to prevent mother-to-child transmission of HIV in the third world. You had two kinds of people who looked at these studies. I mean, you had critics of these kind of studies and you had supporters of these kind of studies. Now, what did these people say? The supporters said was, poor countries can anyway never afford the zidovudine regimen. So what they need is actually single dose, cheap, nevirapine regimens, which need to be tested in scientifically valid protocols, and they needed to be compared against the standard of care. And what was the standard of care? Nothing. So if the standard of care is nothing, they need to be compared against nothing. So that was what the supporters of these studies said. What the critics said is, the use of placebos is actually unethical. When you say standard of care, what you're really referring to is absence of care. So does absence of care amount to standard of care? There was a lot of back and forth in literature, and there were lots and lots of papers written on standard of care, some of which I'll again pass to Dr. Hemlata so that she can circulate to you. And this became known as the standard of care controversy, so much so that Article 29 of the Declaration of Helsinki had to be actually amended. And there were a couple of clarifications written on use of placebo, which is point number 29 of the Declaration of Helsinki. Let's go to another universal ethical requirement, and that is informed consent. How informed is informed? This is a paper which was published in a journal that I work for, done by Professor Gitanjali from JIPMER Pondicherry, published in the Journal of Postgraduate Medicine. Recruitment of subjects for clinical trials after informed consent. Does gender and educational status make a difference? What Dr. Gitanjali did in the study was that she had a mock clinical trial. She designed a protocol. She took ethics committee permission and she randomized patients into two groups. One group received full disclosure and the second group received only partial disclosure of the information that was there. And she looked at how many patients actually consented to participate in these studies. And she also looked at whether educational status and gender, so between men and women, was there a difference in the way people responded to giving consent. And what she found was very important. Irrespective of whether it was full disclosure or partial disclosure, only 30% of patients consented. And the second thing she found was men were more likely to consent than women. And we've also seen that in a lot of clinical trials that we do. You always end up having a lot of males and very few women actually consenting to participate. And the understanding of the consent was very poor. And informed consent is not the onus of the sponsor, it's the onus of the investigator. And this was a very important fact, that comprehension of the entire consent was actually quite poor in the study. So that was what she found about another universal ethical requirement. Let's go to the year 2006. Gitanjali did her study in 2003. This is a study which we have just sent for publication. What we did is we analyzed all research papers which were published in two premier pediatric journals, Indian Pediatrics and Indian Journal of Pediatrics. These are open access journals. You can, you know, take them from the net, download them and look at them. So we looked at how well ethics and ethical processes. And by ethical processes, we are talking about consent, ethics committee approval and assent, because these are pediatric journals. How well are these reported in our Indian journals? We had very interesting findings. There were a total of 132 articles which would have required ethics committee approval, out of which 98 studies were prospective. 39 studies only, that's about less than one third, actually reported ethics committee approval. 46 out of those 98 prospective studies mentioned informed consent from the parents or guardians. 54 out of 98 studies enrolled children over the age of 7 years. However, only 8 of them, that is 14%, mentioned assent. And if we looked at the entire data, only 4 studies, that is 7%, reported all 3, that is ethics committee approval, informed consent and assent. And this is as recent as 2006. So, are we satisfying the universal requirement of informed consent? Let's take another universal requirement, independent review. All your study protocols are supposed to be reviewed by institutional ethics committees and or IRBs. This was a study which was funded by the World Health Organization and the Indian Council of Medical Research, part of which Dr. Vasantha Muthuswamy has published in the Indian Journal of Medical Research in 2005 and 2006. What they did was, they surveyed a lot of ethics committees all over India. They had a checklist and they looked at whether ethics committees kept standard operating procedures, did they keep minutes of the meeting, did they look at attendance, did they look at what happens to the funding, do they have a standard performer for submission, how do they review by meetings, do they review by correspondence, do they review by circulation, do they keep CVs? Do they keep records? Do they have a library which contains guidelines? Do they look at annual reports? And these were the sample questions which I have taken from that questionnaire. Do you check the product for the study? Do you review compensation? Do you insist on a specialty doctor when the study is from an alternative system of medicine? Do you review thesis? Do you review undergraduate student projects? Do you have 2 committees? Do you have an ethics committee and do you have a scientific committee? Do you check the budget? Do you look for another country's ethics committee approval, particularly if it's a multicentric study? And I'm sure you'll guess what the answer is to these questions. Many institutions don't have ethics committees. If they have ethics committees, many of them don't have standard operating procedures. If they have people working on these ethics committees, many of them are not trained. Not only are they not trained, they don't have training facilities. There is variability in the quality of ethical review, and there is lack of a national body to accredit these various ethics committees. And ethics committees may review projects, but do they monitor projects? They lack time for monitoring these projects. So how many of these 7 universal requirements are we really satisfying when we talk about ethics in clinical trials? If you look at the history of ethics, Charak Samhita, 1600 BC, laid down the Medical Code of Ethics. 64 came the Helsinki Declaration. 79 Belmont Report. 2000-2006 ICMR guidelines. And yet we have problems with ethics. Why do we have problems? I think because life has become very, very complex, and ethics is always in the gray zone, and it's believed to have 256 shades of gray. So you can have that many complexities in ethics. Okay. Not only is ethics very complex, research has also become very, very complex. You're today not only talking about drugs, you're talking about medical devices, you're talking about radiation, surgical procedures, research on medical records, biological samples, epidemiology, social studies, behavioral research. So where do you go from here? Ethics basically, why is there a problem with all of this? Ethics basically is a subject which deals with values, principles, beliefs and opinions. It's in a sense like, you know, unlike law, the law says you don't cross the road when the signal is red. Only when it's green and says walk, you cross. That we don't do it is a separate issue, but at least there is a law on that. The law says you wear a seat belt while driving. It's regulation, you have to follow the law. Unlike that, ethics is not a natural science, but it's actually a creation of the human mind. It is therefore open to influence of time, space and situation, and it's something that deals with what is right and what is wrong with human action, character, behavior, therefore completely different from law, which actually regulates how one behaves externally. Additionally, like I mentioned earlier, there are a lot of complexities in the Indian context. India is a developing country, so there's always a sense that you're being exploited. Socio-economic conditions, you are very poor, you're very rich, you have the middle class. Healthcare is available. Is it accessible? Is it efficiently delivered? It's a separate issue. Literacy and education status, 36% I believe are illiterate. Conflicts of interest. The media also plays a lot of role in clinical research today. We are often perceived as being guinea pigs, exploited by somebody coming from outside. And therefore there's question about the credibility of research that we do, the quality of work that we generate, and therefore acceptability of Indian data. There's also issues about what happens beyond the study. Are you just supposed to leave the patients? Are they entitled to receive medication for a lifetime? Are you going to give it to them at a subsidized cost? A lot of complexities in the Indian context, not all of which can be answered easily. What are the pluses from India's point of view? Very nice article in the Lancet. By 2010, it is estimated that a fifth of all global studies will be done in India. And why do people come to India to do studies? We have a large treatment naive population. If you go to developed countries, most of them are treatment experienced patients, right? Highly skilled investigators. We perhaps have the best physicians in the world, and a lot of them are now GCP trained. We speak English well, although I think China is catching up very fast. Excellent technological infrastructure. We are in the IT capital of the country. So we have a lot of technology backup from this point of view. Lower cost of drug development and fast regulatory approvals. But we have a lot of challenges to surmount. What are the challenges from a country point of view? Research ethics itself is a new specialty. So the ICH guidelines came in 96. Our India GCP guidelines came in 2001. So from that point of view, we are still a very young country when it comes to clinical research, and younger still when you're talking about research ethics. Informed consent, like Dr. Gitanjali's paper has highlighted, or even our study from Indian Pediatrics, has its own inherent difficulties. A lot of illiteracy, too many languages, how many translations, how much do patients actually comprehend, and how much time do actually doctors spend talking to patients? How much time do we really spend with our patients, talking to them and explaining to them about disease? Forget about clinical studies. Bioethics is not in our curriculum, barring, I think, the St. John's Medical College, which have a full-fledged bioethics curriculum. No other college in the country has bioethics, and the boom that you see in clinical research in the last 10 years has not been matched by regulatory or ethical reform. There are other challenges as well. This was an international symposium which was conducted in 1998, where people looked at how well countries are capable of doing clinical research, and they actually classified countries into four categories. You had group 1, group 2, group 3 and group 4. Group 1 is like Singapore and Hong Kong, no major feasibility issues, they're capable of conducting good quality GCP studies. Group 2 is minor barriers which could be overcome, Taiwan and Thailand. India, Japan, China, Malaysia, Philippines fell into group 3, significant feasibility issues, but solutions could be found. What were our issues? I'm sure all of you will accept this, our documentation is rather poor. Medical records are often not kept or they're not detailed enough. Second is the process of informed consent. Informed consent that we take in our clinical trials is not up to GCP standards. This is of course a study which was conducted in 1998. There's nothing that's come out later, but I'm sure some part of it, at least the medical record part of it, is perhaps still the same. There are other challenges in our country, limited awareness among investigators themselves. And although you have GCP trained investigators, you would still have these kind of questions coming up. Do all studies require ethics committee clearance? Anyway, I'm just looking at x-rays. Anyway, I'm just looking at records. Do I need ethics committee permission for this? If I decide to do a study, nobody's quite sure how many documents are to be submitted for ethical clearance. And then you have Why should the ethics committee look at the science behind my study? Why they're not bothered only about ethics? Why are they just looking at science? So should the ethics committee be looking at the science and the ethics? Many of them are not familiar with the recent regulatory requirements. And of course, the problems of ethics committees themselves, as I've highlighted earlier, funds not allocated to ethics committees. Many ethics committees members actually cry and say, we don't even have money to drink tea and have biscuits during the meetings. The meetings go on for 6 hours. So no funds, space crunch. The ICMR guidelines say, keep your records for 3 years. The India GCP guidelines say, keep your records for 5 years. Where do you keep them? Where is the space? Infrequent meetings. People don't meet, everything is circulated and then they review it. Limited resources for monitoring. They may do an excellent review of the protocol, but they don't have the mechanism for monitoring. And at times, not all research studies undergo review. So is everything as bad as it looks? No. And there are a lot of good things which have happened in the last 3 or 4 years. So what is the way forward for this country? First is to identify who are the stakeholders. Identify each and every stakeholder in the process of ethics in clinical trials. And there are at least 7 or 8 stakeholders, right from patients to institutions to investigators, sponsors, the regulatory authorities, the healthcare providers, the governmental agencies, science writers, media, society, and non-governmental organizations. Each and every one of these stakeholders has a major role to play in defining and determining ethics in clinical studies. All our agencies actually do a lot of things to promote ethics in clinical research. And these are clips which I've taken from the website. This is from the Indian Council of Medical Research. And if you look at the red circle, ICMR invites applications from Indian biomedical scientists for international fellowships for the year 2007-2008. So your country itself is sending you outside for training. If you look at the DPT website, Indo-Australian or Indo-Australia and Indo-German collaborative programs. So rather than having a foreign person coming into your country to exploit you, as the perception is, the Government of India, Department of Biotechnology actually encourages you to submit projects under the Indo-Australian and Indo-German collaborative programs so that there is transparency from both sides. This is the DST website, Department of Science and Technology, Indo-Japan Cooperative Program. So you find partners outside the country and do research which is transparent and which is ethical. And the Government of India has a lot of initiatives in this regard. Our regulations have also undergone a significant change. You have the India GCP guidelines which were developed. The Schedule Y of the Drugs and Cosmetics Act has been modified, so you can actually do concurrent clinical trials, which means that previously your Schedule Y said that if a drug was in phase 3 outside the country, you need to do studies in phase 2. And now the Schedule Y allows you to do concurrent clinical trials. It is proposed to set up a new agency, which is called as the Central Drug Administration Agency, with funding, which will support the activities of the Drugs Controller General of India. There is a bill in the Parliament where the ICMR guidelines on biomedical research on human participants will soon become law, and the Schedule Y is anyway a statutory requirement. The Indian Council of Medical Research has also taken a lead in putting together a lot of guidelines and publications in the last few years. This is the ICMR guidelines for biomedical research 2006. You have a guidance document on humane care and use of laboratory animals. You have guidelines for assisted reproductive technology 2005, and you have the ICMR DBT guidelines. And somebody was asking me, why do individual agencies put together guidelines? And this is an example of a single national guideline on stem cell research, which is put together by 2 governmental agencies. And this also includes, of course, the Department of Science and Technology. So you have the stem cell guidelines. So you cannot say today that there are no guidelines for stem cell research in this country. And I thought I should just pick up a few examples from the stem cell guideline to tell you how comprehensive these guidelines actually are. They actually categorize research into 3 areas: something which is permissible, which requires your institutional stem cell committee approval. So you need to set up a stem cell committee which is separate from your institutional ethics committee. Restricted studies which would need a national committee's approval, and prohibited studies. For example, in vitro studies on established stem cell lines would constitute permissible research. Creating a human zygote with the purpose of creating a separate stem cell line would constitute restricted research, and cloning would become completely prohibited. This guideline is also very nice in that point number 14, which deals with international collaborations, actually says, and if you look at it, Indian guidelines shall prevail when there is a conflict between the science and ethics of the proposal. So I don't think there can be any clearer guideline than this particular one. Sometime back, India has actually launched the clinical trials registry. So you can't say now that we don't have a clinical trials registry. Previously, we had to pay a lot of money to put our clinical trials into other people's registry, like the WHO registry or the CDC registry. So now you have your own clinical trial registry. And there are also other countries which are taking initiatives to ensure that people who work in developing nations are not actually exploited. For example, these are initiatives from the European Union and the European Commission, which look at improving ethics in clinical trials in the poor and developing nations, which contributes to capacity building, involving researchers right from the initial stages of protocol development, defining who will benefit and how long they will benefit, that is post-trial access, recognizing scientists, Indian scientists, in publications and patents, publishing negative as well as positive studies, and compulsory licensing. And I thought, since I have the mic to me myself, I'll take two slides to blow my own trumpet and say that we've started a course, undergraduate course, which is an 8-week course in clinical research, which is approved by our university, which is the Maharashtra University of Health Sciences, and we run this course twice a year. It's actually an 8-week program, and 1 week, that's the second week, is actually entirely devoted to ethics. So we run this program every Saturday from 2 to 5. It's a voluntary program, so very limited number of students come for this program, and we actually encourage all the students who've done the ICMR short-term fellowships, so that we hope that when they become postgraduates and when they start doing clinical research on their own, they actually become better researchers. Okay, and to finally summarize what I've said so far, why is ethics such a problem? Why is ethics in clinical trials even more of a problem? Because it's something that deals with human mind, and it's a framework which actually determines what is right and wrong with human character, and it's something which changes with time, it changes with influence, it changes with people, it changes with places, unlike law, which is applicable to our external behavior. That's the problem with ethics. This is a clipping from the Hindu. It's a road in Mysore. Okay, I have nothing against Mysore. My city roads are worse than this, actually. But I just got it on the internet. And ethics is something like this road. I mean, it's not a very even ride. It's actually a bumpy ride. But it's really for us to fill in these gaps. And as we have done in our country with the India GCP guidelines, with the ICMR, or the DBT initiatives, we are actually slowly but steadily plugging these holes. And as long as we remember that the two pillars of ethics are the informed consent process and the institutional ethics committees, we should be all right when we do ethical research. Okay?
I have a question regarding multicentric trials. Suppose there are 10 centers and 9 clear the project, and one says this is something they find objectionable, and they send back the proposal. Then in that case, the primary sponsor, what should he do? Should he modify the whole project again, include all that, and then send back all to the to all the 10 centers, or just one? I mean,
this question comes up again and again in a lot of meetings. What happens if there is a multicentric project, and what happens if, say, you have 10 centers and 9 ethics committees actually clear the project, and the 10th ethics committee doesn't clear the project? And that can happen. Okay? There are one of two things which could happen. Thing that is commonly happens is the sponsors are usually reluctant to change the protocol. I mean, they have a set hypothesis, they have a set objective, and they have a set methodology, you know, in doing these studies. And once the 9 centers or the 9 ethics committees actually clear the project, I have seen that they end up dropping the 10th center. That's what usually happens. One way of avoiding these things would be actually to discuss with the researchers a priori. What happens most of the times is protocols are developed outside the country, and then they just come to the researcher. Most of the times they come to the researcher and say, look, this is what we want to do, can you do the study for us? And there is reluctance very often on the part of the sponsor to change anything in the protocol. So sponsors also should have an understanding of the conditions under which they are working, the culture of that particular country, the traditions, the practices of that country, the healthcare systems of that country. And this can be avoided if you have a dialogue with the researcher before you actually begin the study. But in reality, what I have seen really happens is they end up dropping the center where the ethics committee does not approve the study, and the ethics committee is correct in not approving the study if they feel for whatever reason that the protocol is not going to benefit patients of that institution. And this has happened, and I've seen it happen.
Sometimes some sponsors, they do respond by amending, and they do say that we missed this point. In fact, in taking ICMR itself, one of the ICMR institutes, their proposal came for the Central Ethics Committee because that study had a national significance. And then the Central Ethics Committee, naturally they don't have bioethics, trained bioethics, but they have a lot of experience backing them. And when they pointed out certain things, this was actually sent back to them as minutes of the meeting. And the ethics, local ethics committee said, we are very sorry, they had a bioethics, trained bioethics in that group. So we are very sorry, we never even looked at this aspect. So that is sometimes, you know, inadvertent oversight, which sometimes sponsors rectify. But very often, as she said, they drop, because one of the each center may have only 4 or 5 participants to cover, you know. So they easily drop that center.
Yeah, it is in continuation with her question only.
Yes.
We also experienced the same thing. It was a multicentric drug trial. We raised one issue about the blinding of the study. It was an open level study. So we could anticipate the result as soon as we got the protocol. So our query was on that blinding of the study. And then we didn't get any result, any answer from the sponsor when we raised this issue. That means it has gone,
dropped.
So isn't it the responsibility of an ethics committee to raise such issues?
It is very much the responsibility of the ethics committee. The first and the foremost duty is to protect the rights and the safety of the subjects. And if you feel at some point during the protocol that that's not being done, you're well within your rights to reject the protocol or ask for an amendment or ask for a clarification. And you do have instances of one ethics committee rejecting a project and 9 others accepting it, like she said. It does happen. And Dr. Nani said, sometimes the sponsors don't, if it is inadvertent, they change it. 9 out of 10 times, I have seen that they really don't change it.
Yeah.
And I think, I didn't get the data from my ethics committee, but I think in 2006, of all the projects they reviewed, they actually rejected 4 projects, and out of which 2 projects were where the sponsors were not willing to make a change in the protocol based on the suggestions of the ethics committee. One was related to informed consent, and the second was related to placebos. So the ethics committee actually felt that a placebo should not be used, but the sponsors were unwilling to change it. So they got their approval at some other centers and they went ahead with the study, but our institution did not go ahead with the study, and the researcher could not do the study. The sponsors dropped that particular investigator. Multicentric studies also, like Dr. Nandini said, no, they are very small number of subjects sometimes. Mm-hmm. One center gives you 3 or 4 subjects. So it's always easy to pick up another center where you think your chances of approval are higher. But as an ethics committee person and a member, you're well within your rights to reject something that you don't feel is correct and in the interest of the patient.
Then what's your opinion on blinding of a study of clinical trial sort? Means, because open-label studies sometimes give rise to biases, and like our study which we got, that one we could anticipate it from the very proposal. Yes, we know that this will be the result. So that was our query, why you have not blinded the study.
In fact, what we also suggested in the discussion of the paper, that why can't antimalarial falciparum trials be observer-blind? Why don't they just be randomized? One arm receives drug A, the other arm receives drug B. The person who's actually assessing the study doesn't know to which arm the patient belongs. But somewhere down the line, you could have unblinding because one drug is either more effective or one drug has more side effects. And that's the reason why blinding is necessary in certain situations. And the randomized double-blind study is even today believed to be the gold standard. So it all finally depends on the objective of your study and how well you want to prevent biases from keeping into your study. Because it could happen at the end of your study, people say it was an open-label study and therefore the results are not valid. You need to actually repeat it all over again. So everything would depend on your hypothesis, your protocol and your objective. And you have to actually assess it on a case-to-case basis.
The example talks about the Indian pediatrics and these journals, and few percentage reported all those requirements. It does not necessarily mean that the investigators didn't do that. They might have done that. The only thing is that in reporting, they might have skipped that part. We have consort statement for the clinical trials and for the other epidemiological studies also, we have certain other statements. So the publishers rather, or the editorial team, they have a responsibility to that also.
Absolutely. There's one slide which is missed out from this presentation, and that is responsibilities of researchers and responsibilities of journal editors. If your researcher has missed to mention the informed consent, journal editors have an equal responsibility to ensure that that is mentioned and not just edited when you're cutting down on words. Absolutely. Also, the point that he raised is very valid. Just because I mentioned that the consent is not mentioned doesn't mean that the consent was not taken. What we found is, you know, one of the fallacies of the study is we didn't pick up the phone and ask those 132 authors, which we should have done, but we didn't do, that did you take consent? One way of doing, you know, there's a similar study which has been done and people have picked up the phone and asked the authors, did you take consent? If the authors are honest enough, they'll say no or yes. And studies have shown that authors take consent generally for prospective studies. They're absolutely sure, they may or may not mention it. Many of them don't take consent for retrospective studies, studies which involve stored samples, studies which involve many of them. I'm not saying that they don't, all of them don't take, but many of them don't take. So what he's saying is very, very right. The consort statement today actually says that when you report randomized control trials, you have to report 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And consent is a very important aspect of it. In fact, now there is a move by a lot of journals. We've got a letter from a couple of journals which have actually said that, I'm finishing, which said that your journal should publish only those studies which are in line with the consort statement. Very often we end up having studies which don't mention anything about consent. So we are not quite sure how to answer that question. All right. Thank you.